Hello, SCAD family, and a warm welcome is extended to all of our prospective students joining us this evening. I'm Gabriela Iancu, a multidisciplinary artist and photographer based in Atlanta. And today we are going to have a look at the video features of Photoshop and how we can bring our images to life through the creation of a cinemagraph. For those of you who are new to this medium, it is a hybrid of a still image and a moving part that reveals perpetual motion. So today we are going to see how Photoshop helps us to do this. And if you never thought that, you know, Photoshop can help you animate your photographs, today you will learn something new. And I hope that my techniques that I will show to you today will help you and inspire you to get started with creating your own cinemagraphs, experiment, and, you know, eventually incorporate this medium into your own work. But before jumping into Photoshop, I would love to show you some examples of my previous cinemagraph work and introduce you to my work on my website. I started with cinemagraphs in 2013 as a way to enhance my photography. That was happening actually in one of the Photoshop classes I was attending at SCAD. And I've learned so much along the way, and it has been so interesting to incorporate motion into my work. And that's why today I want to show you some of the things that I've learned and how you can achieve the perfect loop in creating a cinemagraph. So right now, I will jump in Photoshop and show you how what are the steps that you need to take to create a cinemagraph. Right here, I have a beautiful photograph of a caramel cake that I shot and styled myself for New Year's. So I want to bring some festive vibe to this photograph and make it feel a bit more celebratory. But before starting with, you know, how you can do that in Photoshop and what features Photoshop has to allow us to do it, I just want to share with you some of the important rules you have to keep in mind when creating cinemagraphs. As mentioned previously, a cinemagraph is a still photograph that has parts of it moving, thus revealing some motion. So when considering to create a cinemagraph, you have to plan and organize yourself in a way that will set you for success, and so that you have, you know, your assets ready to go in Photoshop. If we were to take the example of this still photograph I have right here, my process before shooting this was, I want to create a festive scene with, you know, with a cake and a lot of elements that kind of saying a story. And I think the thing with cinemagraphs is that for it to be successful, it has to have a storyline. So whenever you are decided to start your own process with cinemagraphs, I think it's important to think about the story that you want to convey. Once you have that storyline and you know this is my game plan, then you know everything will kind of come easily to you, and you will know how you can, you know, incorporate motion into your still photographs. So I started by shooting this scene. Everything was shot with natural light, and the next thing that I knew I wanted was how I can incorporate motion into this. And I wanted to incorporate some sparklers because, as I mentioned, it was New Year, so I really wanted to have that festive feeling. And I think with sparklers, you can do so much just because you have all these kind of random sparks that happen. And, you know, you can use that in to your advantage to create that perfect loop in Photoshop. So let's get to work. I will simply drag and drop the video part of my cinemagraph into Photoshop. And because I am dragging and dropping it inside this canvas, you know, the video layer will be placed as a smart object. This is the video part. So as mentioned, cinemagraphs are one part still image, one part video. And a few things that you have to consider when shooting your video part. You really have to use a tripod, because with cinemagraphs, if your motion kind of, if your camera shakes, then the motion that you are capturing will not seamlessly blend with your static image in Photoshop. So try as much as possible to, go prepared to your shoot with a tripod, and, don't do any tilting, panning, or zooming with your camera. Try to keep everything as still as possible, because you only want to capture the motion that's happening in front of the camera, right? And once you have that settled, you have your tripod, you have your camera, everything is framed, you want to keep your camera rolling for at least 10 seconds. You don't need to capture like 1 hour of footage. You just need to have 10 seconds, minimum, that will capture the motion you want to put inside your cinemagraph. And later on, you can edit it in Photoshop and cut exactly the part, the portion that you think it's, the perfect motion for your still image. Another thing you have to consider is, so I have my still image, right? I have my moving part, but then would the light change? If the light changes between the moment when you shoot your still image and then the video, you might have some issues when putting everything together in Photoshop. But thankfully, Photoshop has so many features, and we'll see some of them today, that can help you to fix that discrepancy with the lighting conditions. Ideally, you shoot both the still and the video part at the same time using the same light conditions. But sometimes if you are using, let's say, natural light, light might change, and you might have like small differences in color temperature, but I said, we can always fix that in Photoshop. So just try to keep in mind these rules, always use a tripod, keep your camera rolling for at least 10 seconds, use consistent lighting, and consider the type of movement that you'll introduce into your still image. All right, so with that being said, let's see. So right now we have our two parts of assets that we need to create the cinemagraph. And because I dragged and dropped my video layer, I don't see the timeline. The timeline will be our biggest asset in creating this cinemagraph. So if you don't see the timeline on your Photoshop, just go to Window and then Timeline. And we'll see the timeline opening right here. And we have some options right here. And I think Photoshop is doing such a great job with allowing photographers to incorporate motion into their work. You don't necessarily need to use Premiere or After Effects to get started with cinemagraphs. Photoshop is the best tool if you just want to discover this new medium. So right here at the bottom, we have two options: create video timeline or create frame animation. I think frame animation is really great for animators that want to animate their illustrations in Photoshop. But for today, we are going to use the video timeline. And I see we have a question here in the chat. Someone is asking what type of video layer I'm using. This is an MP4. So if you have a photo camera, you can switch to the video recording feature of your camera, and the camera will record that video for you. And once you have that recording, you can download it to your computer, and then you have an MP4 file. So it's just a regular MP4 file. I haven't done much to it. And you can use other formats. I think MOV is also supported in Photoshop. And you can try and see how those show up. Typically, I use MP4, just such a largely used format, so it doesn't create any issues with incorporating it into the still image. All right, so I will click on this timeline, and now immediately Photoshop, it's showing me what I have on the timeline. This part of Photoshop will be your best ally into creating that loop you need for a cinema graph. And right now, what we see on the timeline is our video layer, but we don't see yet the still image. That's because our background layer, it's locked. If you just unlock it, it will automatically appear. So don't get scared if you see, like, in the layers panels over here, you have two layers, but on the timeline, it's not showing. You just need to unlock it. After you unlock it, you have onto your timeline two layers. The first one that I have right here is the video layer, the video recording I did, which has almost 17 seconds. It's 17 seconds long. So it's, you know, a bit more than 10 seconds, as I mentioned earlier, which is great because with this sparkler, I really wanted to have the entire life cycle, you know, from, you know, starting it and down to burning the last bit of it. So I wanted to decide later on in Photoshop which of it I will use it. And then I have my video layer. So typically you will overlay these two, and then we will see how we can reveal the motion of the video layer. So right now, the first thing that I would do typically after having my assets here in Photoshop would be to see if my video layer is perfectly aligned with my still image. And I'm doing that by lowering the opacity over here. This allows me to see if the two are aligned or not. As we can see right now, they are kind of out of alignment. They don't align. So I'm just going to grab my layer and try to align it as best as possible. We are doing this because, you know, the sparkler will be on top of the cake. So we want the sparkler to be exactly in the position where it needs to be. So, you know, the two images then will look like they belong together. It's all right if you don't align everything perfectly at this step. You can always go back and, you know, make small changes. It's not set in stone at this stage. You just want to get your canvas ready as much as possible for the next step. I think it's all right how it's looking right now. So I'm gonna push the opacity back up to 100. And if I'm turning this on and off, it kind of looks like it's pretty well aligned. And if you are wondering why the video layer kind of looks dark, especially the cake, well, the reason for that is that when I shot the video, I did the exposure for the sparkler. You know, I knew from the very beginning that I'm shooting this video just because I want to capture the movement of this sparkler. So that's why I was mentioning at the beginning, like, you really want to plan your cinemagraph. You want to conceptualize how everything will come together. It's not something that you can do on a fly. So sometimes it's really time consuming. So that's why, you know, kind of everything looks underexposed, because we will not actually use any part of this except for the sparkler. So that's just how I'm doing it, just to make sure that things will look nicely together. And right now, the next step would be, I have my video layer selected, so I'm just gonna apply a quick mask. That's not gonna change anything here. But then I will do Command I and I will invert. That's basically telling Photoshop to hide the layer, but we will use a brush to reveal just part of the motion that we want to incorporate. And in our case, that's the sparkler. And look at this. This is how things come to life. And right now I'm using a brush 100% opacity. I'm doing like loosey-goosey type of brushing. I'm not really concerned with the edges. Like, we can see if I'm painting more of my video layer will be exposed, but I don't want that much. And the reason for that is we want to use the pixels we have in our still image. That's because they are the high resolution on them is so much better, right? The pixels in a video layer, they are moving. You don't have control so much over them. So with pixels in a static image, you have so much more resolution, so much control. So things look crisper, nicer. So you want to reveal just that part of motion that's really necessary. Don't overdo it. Don't, you know, include motion that you don't really need into your cinemagraph, because eventually after we finish it and export it, things will look fuzzy with motion. So we want to show just those tiny parts that really make a difference and really bring our images to life. So if I'm pressing backslash, we will see the mask, and we need to kind of move through our footage and see, you know, how much this sparkler it's extending, because, you know, all these sparks go around. We have to kind of, you know, design our mask and use the brush in a way that's, you know, going around this. So we reveal only the portion we need and hide those areas that we don't need. And, you know, with cinemagraphs, it's always like, it's a lot of work in the sense that you have to kind of sit down and check your timeline right here and see what is your footage saying? What are you being given with these images that you've been shooting? So you try to get the best part of those, you know, 10 to 17 seconds and use just those. And right now I will just keep this for now like this. We can always go back and adjust our mask to incorporate those, you know, areas we want. But for now, I feel like, you know, it's good. And the next step that I will do typically would be to decide on the duration of a cinemagraph. The longer your video is, and the longer the portion you include into your cinemagraph, you know, the heavier your file will be. And if you plan to export this as a GIF format, then, you know, the size will be really huge and, you know, the quality will be decreasing, because that's how the video format, the GIF format works. But if you were to export this as an MP4 file, and I will show you towards the end how you can do that, then you get much more leverage in terms of how colors and quality of your cinemagraph would be. So for that, it's important to, you know, cut your footage, keep only the portion that you really need. So we have right here 17 seconds. That's a lot. I mean, we more certainly don't need 17 seconds, neither 10. So I want this cinemagraph to be maybe 3 seconds tops. You might think that, oh my God, 3 seconds, 3 seconds is not enough, but you will see that 3 seconds is more than enough. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna use my timeline and try to crop this in a way that's, you know, revealing the best moment of this sparkler. So let's see. And right here you can see, right here at the bottom, you can see how much time it's been since the start point towards the end point. So you can, you know, decide like, I know that second 18 something happened, so I will crop my footage there, you know, something like that. It depends on you, because you are behind the camera, so you know what exactly happened. So I would say I really like how the sparkler looks here. So I'm gonna grab this and just position it here at the playhead. And then I'm gonna grab the playhead and scrub to my footage. And maybe, I don't know, keep it at mark 3 seconds. And then I'm gonna grab the other side, and this will be the actual portion of the moving part of my cinemagraph. So this is the way how it looks right now. Let me just play through it. And, you know, video formats in Photoshop, take a little bit longer to be read by the app. So if you feel like when you hit play or space bar to have your video layer played, you feel like it's going slow, that's totally normal. It's just the way how Photoshop reads the files. And then after they are being read and they are, you know, in the memory of the app, you get this very smooth type of motion. So don't feel like your computer is too slow. It's just the way how Photoshop works. So right now we have this beautiful loop, and this kind of happened naturally. And I think I chose this example because it's easy to understand the concept of cinemagraph. And that is, you need to have a seamless loop. Your start point, which is over here, and your end point should match. Once they are matching, you have the perfect loop. And a success, that's cinemagraph, that's not revealing to your viewer how you did it. If someone sees the start and end point, then they will know this is just a video playing, right? It's not a cinemagraph. So you want to be smart about how you choose these points. And there are different techniques how you can fake your way through making that seamless loop. And the first one and the easiest one and the one that works the best is with, you know, repetitive movements and actions and things that happen randomly, like a sparkler. So that's why this is the perfect example to get you started in and put you in this mood of, oh, this is how a cinemagraph should go about. And the first technique of creating your loop is just a hard cut. You look at your footage, you find the sweet point, and then you cut it. That's it. You don't do anything. There is no need to do anything else than just you staring at your timeline until you find that sweet spot. Once you find it, that's it. It's so easy. So for me right here, the sweet spot was because I kind of see that here at 15 seconds, the sparkler looks like this. And then at mark 3, kind of looks like that. And because it's kind of happening randomly, you know, it looks sort of natural when it's happening. And that's it. This is the first technique of how you can create your perfect loop. It wasn't difficult, right? So right now, since we have so much, you know, footage on our timeline, we don't need all of this. We don't need to keep our files being so heavy after saving them. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna use my cursor here, and I'm gonna cut this video layer, and I can use the scissors for that, and boom, that's it. And this part, I don't need it. I already decided on my loop. I have the best part of this recording. I'm gonna get rid of the rest, so I'm deleting it. So right now, we have the final version of our cinemagraph. And this is how it's looking. It's looking pretty well, actually. And again, the reason why it's moving so slowly is because Photoshop is reading again my layers. I made some changes. So each time you are making changes to your timeline, this will happen. You might wonder, what about this difference in color and exposure? How we can fix that? Of course, Photoshop is so great at fixing these things. And just because you are using a video layer doesn't mean that you cannot use all the features that Photoshop typically has for photographs. So for that, I'm gonna just select my video layer, which has a mask. And then I'm just gonna use a simple curves adjustment that I'm gonna clip to my video layer, because we want only the video layer to be affected. So right now we are trying to match the exposure of the video layer to that of the still image. So I'm just gonna darken it a little bit like that. And you can see already it's making a huge difference. And then the next thing, I'm gonna apply a color balance adjustment. I'm gonna clip this one as well. And you know, with my still work, my still photographs, I know that everything is kind of shifting towards the blue palette. So I know that I need to bring my video layer to look kind of the same. So I'm gonna increase my cyan levels. And we are actually looking pretty good. Look at this, it's almost matching. Then we can maybe work on the shadows a little bit.
Gabriela, this is looking so great. We have a question for you. For your cinematograph with the rotating cookie, when it's an unnatural movement, how do you make something like that to have a seamless start and end?
Well, with the cookie, everything was kind of directed in the behind the scenes. So I wanted to make sure that I got that seamless movement before, you know, starting my camera. So it's just a way of you playing enough behind the scenes and making sure that when you spin the cookie, it's kind of rotating naturally. But when you don't have things that kind of happen naturally, then I think the only way how you can achieve a more organic, seamless loop is by cutting on your frames, like maybe jumping some of the frames that, you know, create repetitive motion, so that you don't have too much of abrupt things moving. But that would be maybe some more advanced techniques that you need to do to make that happen. So, but I would say that the best way to make something look natural is when you set your scene, like what's in front of you, that's the best you can get. Of course, the tools we have today can help us to fake that or improve that, but the best way to actually make it happen is through, you know, your hands when you set everything up before your camera. Right now, let's see, I will play again through my cinemagraph and see. So I have adjusted the color balance and the exposure with the curves adjustment layer. And let's see. Things look pretty awesome, I would say. Look at this. I really like it. So let me just quickly zoom in and make sure that you want to zoom in as closer as you can get and see that all the tiny details make sense. But don't overdo it. Sometimes, you know, things that you might see, you know, might not be so obvious to somebody that's seeing your work for the first time, but try to get as close as possible to having your work and your loop as seamless as possible. So I think right now I really like it. I don't see anything that's, you know, really bothering me at this point. I would say that maybe I can do something about the sharpness. It feels like, you know, the cake is a bit more sharp than the footage. So maybe I can do something about that. And again, remember you are in Photoshop, so you can apply all the cool filters that you would typically apply to your still images and make them awesome. You can do the same with video layers. So let's do some sharpen on this. Oh, I'm sorry. You have to be on the actual video layer to do that. So once again, filter, sharpen. And I will sharpen this. Let's see, close. And it's already looking sharper than before. This is a cool trick for you to use because sometimes, you know, things you shoot with your video camera will not look as sharp as your still images. Again, because pixels are moving and stuff starts to shift around, you might lose some of that sharpness you initially had. So this is a nice way of you fixing that before exporting your cinemagraphs. And one last look. I think it looks awesome. All right, so right now we have our first cinemagraph. Let's see how we can export it. So if you want to export this to Instagram and use it on social media, the best way to do it is exporting this file as an MP4. We have a little arrow right here that says render video. If I'm gonna click on it, I'm gonna have this window open. That's basically allowing me to set some settings and export this in an MP4 format. we can use this H.264 codec. This is a widely used video codec, especially for the internet and broadcasting. It's very reliable. Of course, we want to have as much quality as possible. Since it is an MP4 file, we can afford the luxury to export it in high quality, because typically they tend to be, you know, smaller in size, these files. And then we want to export the work area, which is right now it shows like 15 to 89. The work area is basically this portion that we selected right here on our timeline. And that's saying to the tool that we want to export only that. And that's it. After you hit render, Photoshop will export all of these assets you put together, and then the final output would be an MP4 file. If you, for whatever reason, if you don't want an MP4 file, then you can do the typical GIF format. So you go to file, export, and then we have save for the web. And this will open a window. And right here, we can select GIF. And then we have some options I'm not going to do it right now because it's taking so much time to actually read the file. So when you use this option, just be mindful and very patient that this takes time. It takes much longer time to export a cinemagraph in GIF format than actually to do it. But once you have the options shown right here, just make sure that your looping options are set to forever, because you want your GIF file to loop forever and not stop. And then you will be good to go. Basically, that's the end of your workflow. And that's how you create your first cinemagraph. I really hope that this session has been inspiring for you guys and will motivate you to get started with creating cinemagraphs and experiment. I think you have to experiment a lot with this technique and make it your own. Think about stories you want to portray with this technique. There are so many things you can do with it. The medium is so engaging. So definitely there will be so many opportunities to showcase this everywhere. And if you have any other questions that I didn't have time to answer during the workflow, don't hesitate to pop them in the chat.
We have, we're going to try to get at least one or two more in here. But one of the things that people are noticing is that your composition and the photography and then the edit is amazing. Like, you are an incredibly talented photographer to begin with. And these cinemagraphs are elevating your work, certainly, but you have great work to start with. So do you have any tips for creating like great photos to work from and nice edits like we have here?
Oh yeah, definitely. I would say that, for a successful cinemagraph, you really need to have a story. And I think we have seen so many examples on the internet with cinemagraphs that, you know, don't look great. Just because you put motion into something, it doesn't necessarily make it some form of art. So I would say that for me, my work typically revolves around this idea of exploring the still life genre. So I like to construct my images. Everything you see in my portfolio has been constructed. And as someone that doesn't really go out and find these things, of course, these things don't really happen by themselves. I fabricate them in my studio. So I spend a lot of time thinking about what's the story that I really want to convey, how I can make it happen. Do I need particular props to make it happen? And I really love this process. You know, getting to, you know, creating the photograph is as exciting as taking the photograph. So I spend time on deciding the props, the colors, the textures. And as you saw in this picture right here, like, nothing that I put together in this scene, it's random. Everything thought out in a way that, you know, I want to have this very kind of whimsical moment that, speak speaks for, you know, everyone. It feels festive and celebratory, and I have all these props that, you know, help me to say the story, and everything, you know, has a particular color because that's how I typically work. I work with complementary colors, and that's something that helps you to, you know, make things pop on the screen. You know, blue and orange work well together. Red and green, of course, they work well together as well. So working with complementary colors helps you in achieving something that's looking a bit more vibrant and has more character to it. And that's my style, and I've been working to refine it for some years already. But I would say my advice would be to just explore with setting your composition in different ways and concentrating on what's the story you want to tell. Once you have that and you know what's the story, then it will come so easily. Also with creating cinemagraphs, you will know immediately, oh, I want to spin a cookie because it's fun, but also because it says something with that. And eventually with practice, you need a lot of practice. Eventually you will get to that point really satisfied with how things look. Any other questions?
No, that's great. Let's sign off.
All right. Well, it has been such a pleasure doing this workshop with SCAD, and I hope this has been inspiring for everyone. And hopefully this will get you started with creating cinemagraphs. If anyone has any questions, don't feel free to get in touch with me, and I will be happily helping you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.